Well, good morning and welcome to our DMAC Ask a Professional event. Thank you all for being here. We are very excited to have Lucas Woodland here with us today. He is a senior digital forensics investigator for Pratum. And our hope really with these events are that they're linking your education and maybe your career interests to professionals that work in those industries. Before we get started, I just want to say a quick hello as your host. My name is Jill Hoik. I work a part of the work-based learning team here at DMAC, and I'm accompanied by my colleague, Amy Stainhook, and she will be kind of engaging a little bit more in the chat too as well. But I just would like to mention that at DMAC here, we do have an information technology pathway that encompasses a lot of different areas, but one is cybersecurity, we have digital forensics, network administration too as well. So for those of you that are interested, and we will leave the pathway link in the chat for you to receive a little bit more information in regards to that. But without further ado, I would love to introduce our professional for today. Like I mentioned, we have Lucas Woodland. He serves as the Senior Digital Forensics Analyst for Pratum. And Pratum is located here in Ankeny, Iowa, but Lucas is actually located up in the Twin Cities area. And so he'll kind of talk a little bit about that too as well. But Lucas, thank you so much for giving us your time today and for us to learn a little bit more about your profession.
Thanks for having me.
So I am going to start with the first question here, but for those of you that are on the call, we would love for you to ask Lucas questions too. But I'm going to start us off here. Lucas, can you just kind of talk a little bit about your background, kind of how you got to where you are today, maybe how you chose this career path, what you went to school for, and just kind of the journey that got you to where you are today?
Sure thing. So my journey started, I went to college at the University of Iowa, and I went through the Air Force ROTC program. When I was in that program, I decided that I wanted to apply for the Office of Special Investigations, which is like the FBI for the Air Force. And then when I did that, one of my commanding officers was like, "Do you know that they have a computer crimes division?" And I was like, "No, I don't know. I don't even know what that is." But they're like, "You like computers." I was a MIS degree. And I applied and then was accepted into OSI as a cybercrime investigator. So my education was not digital forensics. I honestly don't know, it would be about 20 years ago, if there was a digital forensics program back then anywhere. But I got all my initial training through the federal government. So did the basic investigations and then computer crimes, incident response, and started doing some vendor-specific training with Guidance Software and NCASE. Did that for about 4 years, and then decided to get out of the military and went and worked doing very similar work for Target Corporation, and was on their global investigations team. Any type of employment issue, if there were any breaches for Target. One interesting thing when I was at Target, they would also volunteer their services to local law enforcement. So we did actually do some law enforcement cases. I even went out on a search one time with a local agency for a check fraud case, just to help them identify evidence that they would need to. And then I've kind of bounced back and forth between working corporate, kind of the investigations or forensics, and then as a consultant, doing incident response, digital forensics, e-discovery. And then I've been with Pratum for the last 2 years.
Awesome. Thank you for that summary. That's great. A lot of different facets to that. So would you say that, I know you said you went to school a while ago, but that, you know, potentially there wasn't a degree specifically in digital forensics. Would you say that a lot of people that work in the industry now have some sort of digital forensics degree? Are you seeing a lot more of that? And is it a requirement moving forward now? Or can you talk a little bit about the education requirements?
Yep. Yeah, it's definitely more common. Unfortunately, I don't do the hiring, so I don't know what a lot of the requirements are, but I do believe it's definitely, obviously, digital forensics or cybersecurity is very important. And I think it's great that there are those programs out there that specifically help people that are interested. Because like I said, when I got into it, I had no idea that it was even an option. And my belief, there's probably a lot of people that, well, I know it is because I tell people what I do and they're like, or I tell them what my title is and they're like, what do you do exactly? So it's great that people can get that formal education to have a path to get there. And then a lot of times what I see is for employers is also having some type of certification with that. There are definitely entry level roles that I believe that you can get in without the certification. But those certifications definitely help as well.
Awesome. And you kind of led me into my next question, but when people ask you what you do, how do you describe what you do for those that on the call maybe don't fully understand what a digital forensics investigator does in their day-to-day? And then on the back end of that question, if you just want to kind of walk us through a typical day, which maybe there isn't really a typical day, I'm sure it probably changes. Yep. But just kind of walk us through that and explain a little bit about what you do.
Sure. So now I got lost. What was the...
Yeah. Can you just explain what a digital forensics investigator does? And then maybe like a day-to-day tasks that you do.
Gotcha. Yeah. So when people do ask me, the first thing that I tell them, unfortunately, because it's in the news so much these days, is if somebody gets hacked or their data is stolen. That's one of the big things that we do is we respond to those incidents. We come in afterwards, identify how the attackers got in, and then what the exposure is. Were they in there for a long time? Did they steal data? And today, I mean, it's rampant, the ransomware. And then trying to give them some source of who it was, but that's really a very difficult part. Other aspects of a digital forensics investigator are employment cases or theft of secrets. So if a company has an employee that does sales and they leave the company and for whatever reason they feel that they have the right to the customer list and they take it, companies will ask us to investigate, to provide them with the evidence to show that they basically have a legal case. And then the other aspect kind of goes hand in hand with digital forensics is e-discovery. So if a law firm is in a litigation and any documents or email, because that's what everybody uses these days, is involved, they'll ask us to go collect the evidence, preserve it, make sure that nothing's altered, and then search that data and provide them with any data that's relevant, where in the past, before computers, discovery was all documents and phone records and things like that. But these days, almost everything is digital.
Yeah, that's awesome. And so when you mentioned you worked at Target and you were specifically, you know, a digital forensics professional for them, can you talk a little bit about what Pratum does? And in regards to that, obviously, I'm assuming you work with quite a few different businesses, but explain a little bit about what Pratum is for those on the call.
Yep. So Pratum, the digital forensics is one small piece of what Pratum provides. We are a cybersecurity services company. So we provide a wide range of services from security monitoring, the digital forensics and incident response, virtual CISO, penetration testing, a lot of all those aspects is what Pratum does. And my specific area, is the digital forensics and incident response. So if a company does get breached or has some insider type of case or legal issue, if they don't have the services like Target did, because most companies aren't that big, they'll contact us and reach out to us. We also work a lot with law firms, because if somebody does get hacked or they do have a legal issue, one of the first calls they're going to make is to their legal counsel. So then we're there as well to help the law firm and the company out.
Awesome. We have a couple questions in the chat, so thank you all for engaging. The first question is, can you collect data from text messages and Google activities that have been deleted?
For text messages, yes, we can. On mobile phones, the data is more volatile than it is on a computer or a hard drive. But yes, that is definitely something that we get asked to collect. And then, because of text messages, the different Facebook Messenger, all those different apps, that's what everybody's using. That's definitely something that we get asked to recover and analyze a lot. And then the Google activity, sometimes we can. It depends on what log data is available. And there is, for Google Drive specifically, there is a lot of log data that people don't realize is going on in the background, that then we're able to provide those answers and insights into the activity of that person.
Great. And the next question is, how many hours on average do you work in a week?
This might be an answer that I give a lot this morning, but it does depend. One of the aspects with digital forensics and specifically incident response is that it's a responsive career field. We get called when things don't go well for people. And it doesn't, we always joke, the bad guys don't work a 9-to-5. So it just depends on what my caseload is. Some weeks it can be a normal about 40 hours a week. Some weeks, if it's a major incident, a company has been hacked and there's ransomware and they're all their operations are down, we're working not round the clock, but as close as we can. So it can range, 80 plus hours a week sometimes. It just, unfortunately, it depends.
Yes, absolutely. Can you retrieve data when someone uses private browsing?
We can sometimes retrieve artifacts because when something is deleted on a hard drive, it's still on the hard drive. It's just, we like to say kind of an analogy. If you've got a book in a library and somebody steals the card catalog record of it out, that book is still there. It's just the record of it is gone. So on a computer, that data is still there. It's just, when is it going to get overwritten by other data? So that's how that private browsing works, is it's out there. It's just not stored and cataloged for, like, with regular browsing history that you can go back and see later on.
Interesting. What are our compliance obligations regarding private data?
That is definitely a legal question, and we do refer to our legal counsel or the company's legal counsel, but I know it depends on the industry you're in. Healthcare is personal health records or personal health information. PCI is for credit card data. It all depends on the industry you're in and what requirements are around that entity or what the government says you must do. So yeah, it's industry, I'll say industry specific.
Awesome. Do you do digital background checks?
No, we don't.
Okay. How long do typical investigations take?
Again, going back to that, depends. It depends on the amount of data. So if it's employee leaves the company, and we need to do the analysis of their laptop or their laptop and phone, that can be as quick as a couple days. If it's a larger data breach for a large organization where we need to collect and analyze multiple servers, workstations, that can be several weeks long to identify the full scope of what happened. So it depends, but I'd say most cases that we get are, the smaller cases are 2 to 4 days.
Awesome. That's a lot quicker than what I was thinking. So thank you. Great questions in the chat, everyone. Thank you for asking these questions. What are other types of crimes do you investigate?
So I don't investigate them being with Pratum, but another thing like law enforcement, basically any type of case that's involved that could have digital evidence involved. So if it's a drug case and it's a drug dealer and they have a phone, they've got phone records of everybody they talk to. Really it can be any type of crime that includes digital evidence. I know cybercrime is focused on data breaches, and hacking, but really it's anything that somebody could use to further a crime is then in our, I'll say our arena for what we can investigate.
That's great. Did knowing your data is accessible make you more cautious? I guess maybe I'm assuming her question means, being in the field, are you pretty cautious on the internet knowing how accessible everything is for people like yourself?
Yes. I would definitely say I am more cautious than the average person because of what I've seen, what I know. And not to be the worry wart, but the unfortunate, what we tell people is that if somebody wants your data or they want to get in bad enough, they will figure out a way. The fortunate thing I think for a lot of us though is most people don't care about us. The bigger concern that I would say individuals need to have is the unfortunate part is where is all of your data stored? Do you have accounts with major retailers, all of your medical records, things like that? That's the scary part to me is because I need to trust them to do the right thing and to be security conscious. But we all know that that's not always the case because a lot of times businesses are more focused on functioning and being operational. And then if security gets in the way of that, it doesn't get the priority it needs to unless something bad happens. And then that's when they make it a priority after the fact.
Yes, absolutely. And to kind of go along with that, a question was, can we effectively detect an attempted or successful cybersecurity incident before the attack or data breach? Like, are there ways that we can kind of see, know that prior or?
Yes. Yep. Okay. You definitely can. And that's one of the other services that Pratum actually offers is our SOC, our Security Operations Center, where we set up and monitor a company's network and devices. So we'll have monitors out there that will collect logs and watch the activity of the computers and the servers, the firewall data, collect and analyze all that to give us alerts so that hopefully we can prevent it or identify it. Obviously, the prevention piece is in having the firewalls set up, keeping things patched up to date, things like that. But yeah, there's definitely layers of defense and monitoring that can be done. The unfortunate part is that not all organizations do that because of different varying reasons. And that's something we run into. Our ability to do a good investigation and provide answers depends on the level of evidence that's available. So if we go into a company, they say, hey, we're a small company. We got ransomware, but we don't have any network logs. We don't really have, we've got this one person that kind of does IT for us. It'll be very difficult to identify what happened in a case like that, where if you go to a company that has somebody like Pratum to monitor it, if it isn't caught right away, it'll be caught quicker. And then there'll be that data that'll be retained automatically that we can use for our investigation.
Interesting. Is the job competitive?
Yes, it is competitive, but the demand is so high that, especially right now, because of the continued data breaches and the bad guys just don't stop, that there's a definite demand that if you get into it, I don't see anybody having an issue getting a job in this field just because the demand for the work is so high, especially in the incident response that the hacking cases. Now, if it's more focused like on the corporate, like I said, it's gotta be a larger company that's gonna have the money to invest in that. But yeah, you can definitely, I don't think there'll be an issue with people wanting to get into this career field anytime soon.
That's great. Do you just do the analyzing part, or do you also do the physical search for the flash drive or computer that is suspected of being used in a crime?
So if it's a legal or a criminal case, that's all handled by law enforcement. And then a lot of times for our clients, it'll be their investigations team or security team that will collect all of the evidence. We can go on site and help them with that. But a lot of the times we give them guidance, they go collect the evidence and then bring it to us. And then that's when we start our chain of custody to show that we haven't changed anything. We preserve it so that if the case does go to trial, we can say, this is exactly what we got. And then I can testify and say, this is what I did, this is what I found. And then the attorneys take it from there.
Interesting. If a cybersecurity breach occurs, what is the plan to handle it, and how effective is this plan?
So the plan, and we just, one of the things that I do, if we're not, like say I don't have a lot of cases at the time, or we have a client that comes up, we'll do incident response exercises for companies. So one of the big things is for companies to have an incident response plan in place so that they know, okay, this incident happened, and then these are the steps that we take. And hopefully it's secure the evidence, or like segregate the devices that are involved, and then contact somebody like us so that we can get involved right away and then start our investigation. And then the investigation piece usually runs in parallel to the remediation. So a company wants to know what happened, but if it's a bigger incident, they can't wait weeks or months to know what happened. They need to get back up and running and back to business.
That's great. Always having a plan, right?
Yeah. A plan is huge. And a lot of times though, it is where we will get contacted several weeks, sometimes even months after the incident, because the company didn't know what was going on. And they didn't know what to do, or they'll think they solved the problem initially. And then they get basically hacked a second time. And they're like, okay, we couldn't do it the first time, so now we need help.
Yeah. What would you say has been your biggest win in your career this far?
I don't know if I have like a biggest win. Part of, I'll say, I guess what I get the most satisfaction with is actually being able to help a company identify who actually did the bad act and help them recover from it. So if it is a business email compromise, like somebody gets defrauded for hundreds of thousands of dollars, we might not be able to identify the specific person that did it, but we can help the company recover and then help them to figure things out, recover some of the money if it was lost, and then prevent it from happening in the future. I know when I was at Target, when they first got breached back, I can't remember what year it was. There were a bunch of retailers that got hacked, stole a bunch of credit card data. That investigation, and it wasn't just our work, but part of our work helped to actually identify the people involved, and there were arrests made. So that's always satisfying, especially with my background when I came from law enforcement with the Air Force. It's always good to, I'll say, catch the bad guys.
Yeah, coming full circle for sure. What would you say is a big challenge in your profession?
Keeping up to date.
Probably all of it.
staying current with all of the vulnerabilities, the different data breaches, because every day there are new vulnerabilities, there's new attacks. The attackers change the way that they set up an attack, change their malware. It's challenging to stay current in this field, in any cybersecurity. But it's, at the same time, it's fun. It is challenging, so you're never going to get bored of what you're doing.
Yeah, it doesn't sound like you would ever be bored in digital forensics. No. If you could start all over again, would you change your career path in any way?
I don't think so. The way that I got started, it worked out very well. Maybe one of the things, had I known in college at the time, maybe I would have gone into more of an IT specific or information security program. But that's hindsight, and it's always 2020.
Absolutely. I ask that question to a lot of professionals when I do these events, and they all kind of say the same thing. Like, I'm not going to live in the past, but yeah, I love what I do. And so, yeah, great answer. I just want to be respectful of time. So if you have any last minute questions, please ask them now. But one of the questions that I always like to end on, Lucas, is for those students who are tuning in that are thinking about a profession in digital forensics or cybersecurity, what advice would you give them in regards to having a profession in digital forensics or cybersecurity?
Yeah, definitely. As a student, if you are interested, find one of those programs that are out there, because it will set you up very well. And I was talking to our penetration guys recently as well. It's continuing to understand the basics. So understanding how the computers work, how traffic goes over the internet, through the firewall, packets, all that stuff, because your job is to investigate all that. And then just try and stay current, because, like I said, there's a lot of data breaches in the news. So you start reading, and the stories can be frustrating, but at the same time, they're very interesting, because they're like, oh, there's this new group, or there's this new attack. And then, yeah. And then you can just do a lot of research on your own. And I think with a lot of careers too, is just, not settling don't just settle. If you do go through a cybersecurity or digital forensics program, don't just settle on the education that you get. You need to stay current. So go out and build on that base education that you get so that you can be the best in your field and stay current.
That's great. That's awesome advice. We did have one last question in the chat. You kind of covered it, I feel like, in your last answer. But since the internet always evolves, how do you constantly keep up with the new ways of hacking? I mean, you just mentioned a lot of research, maybe even on your own time too, as well. But how do you keep up with all the new ways of hacking and the evolution of that?
Yep. Staying on different mail lists. Checking different websites, and then also continuing to go to training. At Pratum, I get annual training that I can go to, and then continuing to do different webinars. But yeah, that's that staying current by just reading, researching, like you said, so that you do know. And a lot of times it can be where a case will come in, because it'll be a 0-day attack. And then it's as I'm investigating, continuing to research, and it's like, okay, this isn't just an isolated incident. It's a broad incident. It's impacting thousands or hundreds, thousands of companies. So that then it's kind of that not really groupthink, like formally, but the good part with the internet is people do share. There's companies out there that'll share their findings. And then as an investigator, we can use that to assist and corroborate with the work we're doing.
Yes. Wow. So interesting. I want to wrap up this event because I want to be respectful of your time, Lucas, but thank you so much for giving us your time and learning a little bit more about a profession in digital forensics and all that entails. I appreciate it. For those of you on the call, thank you for tuning in. You all had such great questions. My colleague Amy did leave a survey in the chat, so we would love for you to fill that out and tell us how we did here. But I will conclude our event. Thank you again for everybody tuning in to our Ask a Professional Digital Forensics Investigator. Thank you, everybody.